It's no secret that tech product sales have been a disaster after the pandemic. During the pandemic, major manufacturers sold phones, laptops, TVs, PCs and tablets like crazy. Corporate logic dictated in a stupid but not unusual way that these sales levels should be maintained or even surpassed. Well, what followed was a cold shower. I mean, in 2020-2021, historical sales records were set. What else were people imprisoned in their own homes supposed to do but stare at screens? But companies didn't think, oh, we made billions that will last us for years to come. However, things eventually stabilized naturally. What's interesting though is that prices, at least for certain product segments, remained high. And right now, the most important question for me is this. What was the main thing that drove sales growth this year? At first glance, you might be tempted to say AI. But the answer is not exactly. A recent IDC study shows that AI capabilities are not what's driving the increase in PC sales. On the contrary, the purchase of new laptops and PCs is actually driven by the simple, usual need to replace the old ones. Moreover, more and more analysts have concluded that users don't even appreciate the AI capabilities of these devices, and that's because, at the moment, there's no immediate practical application for them in the sense that the office worker or gamer doesn't find these AI advancements immediately useful for their daily tasks. And the overhype of artificial intelligence is starting to have the opposite effect, to the point where it's turning people away. This situation reminds me of years ago when there was a heated debate about VR headsets. I used to talk about virtual reality in my videos and people would ask in the comments, which good, cheap, 24-inch gaming monitor they should buy. It's the same now. People still don't understand what's the deal with that NPU and why they should pay for something that doesn't have a concrete and immediate use in their day-to-day tasks. To rephrase the earlier joke in this context, it would go like this. Generative AI is great, but how many frames does it pull in CS2? It's no coincidence I started this video in this way. God forbid I'm not bashing progress. But there's a distinction between real needs and invented ones, between the concrete present and promises. And if late 2023 may have been the year of the LLM explosion, 2024 is the year in which hardware has aligned with this trend. It started with a bang, with Qualcomm entering the ultra-portable laptop market, followed by AMD with their Ryzen AI series, and recently Intel joined the fray with their Lunar Lake series. All these hardware launches had one thing in common, that neural processing unit dedicated exclusively to AI scenarios. But this revolution also brought something important, efficiency and battery life. Another positive side is that Qualcomm's entry into this market has awakened traditional players, Intel and AMD, from their slumber. Snapdragon X set efficiency, battery life and performance records that became the standard, and Intel and AMD seem to have taken note of this lesson, coming out with new, more efficient models while trying to capitalize on the compatibility advantage of their x86 architecture. Last summer, AMD released the Ryzen AI series, and I tested the HX370 and a couple of weeks ago the more modest 365. Both impressed me with good battery life, perfect app compatibility, and high performance. AMD's HX370 crushes the Snapdragon X Elite in terms of raw power, but is not as energy efficient as the latter. And recently, Intel joined the competition with their Lunar Lake series. I'll spoil it for you. While AMD leaned towards performance at the expense of battery life, Intel seems to have taken the opposite direction, which is kind of surprising for Intel. And after this necessary context, let's dive into specifics. What you see here is the first laptop with Intel's new processor that we got our hands on, the ZenBook S14 with the Core Ultra 7 258V. I'll compare it head-to-head with other laptops I've tested in recent months, namely the VivoBook S15 with the Snapdragon X Elite from Asus and the Lenovo Yoga Pro 7 with the Ryzen AI 365, as well as the ZenBook S16 with the Ryzen AI 9 HX370. So, let's get to work. I'll start with the laptop itself. The first thing that strikes me is that Asus chose to play it safe. The ZenBook S14 follows the design line, look and feel of recent models in this series, without taking any risks or creative liberties. It goes for a tried and tested design and construction, probably based on the principle, if it ain't broken, don't fix it. Of course, that doesn't mean the laptop doesn't look and feel excellent, just like we felt about the X16 model with AMD. Even the design on the lid or the small Asus ZenBook logo in the top left corner is in its place, as is the pattern of silver lines that streak across the lid. On the bottom, you'll find the ventilation grille and those rubber inserts meant to lift the laptop above the desk and facilitate airflow. The screen edges are thin and refined, and the aluminum chassis is robust and rigid. Once opened, the laptop looks simple, if not downright minimalist. It's extremely thin and light, weighing just over 1 kilo, 1.2 to be exact. And under these conditions, I think the connectivity deserves praise. For such a thin laptop, the S14 has an impressive collection of ports, a USB 3.2 Gen 2 full size on the right, two Thunderbolt 4 ports on the left that also double for charging, a full-size HDMI 2.1 and a combo jack for headphones and microphone. And all this in one of the most compact Ultrabooks ever. Its 13mm thickness when folded makes it only slightly thicker than a phone, and despite its slim silhouette, it feels solid. Another impressive thing is that Asus managed to fit a gorgeous 14-inch OLED display with 2880 pixels by 1800 and a 120 Hz refresh rate, and is also touch capable. Interestingly, this last addition, which usually adds thickness and weight to screens, doesn't seem to have a significant impact here. According to our measurements, the display covers over 100% of the DCI-P3 color space and has around 340 nits of brightness. It won't burn your retina, but it compensates with the specific features of OLED. Vibrant colors, deep blacks, infinite contrast. I won't go over the whole list of praises again, it's as we established when we measured the display on the S16. In terms of interaction, the device comes with an elegant, well-spaced keyboard, the keys have a travel distance of 1.1 mm, and there's a whole suite of narrower media keys in the top row. The keyboard is good. Period. I won't go into much detail, just know that. The trackpad got as much space as Asus could allocate on this chassis, so it stretches from the edge of the case all the way to the spacebar. Gestures work pretty well, and besides the usual Windows gestures, Asus added a few of their own. For example, you can adjust brightness with a swipe along the right edge of the touchpad and change the volume with a similar swipe on the left. The sound is also impressive for such a thin laptop. It even has some bass and gets quite loud, though at maximum volume it sounds a bit cluttered. An interesting note is that since it has downward facing speakers, it sounds better when placed on a hard surface like a desk. Before we move on to performance, let's talk a bit about modularity, which is sublime but completely absent. The only component that can be replaced is the NVMe SSD, while all the other components are soldered to the motherboard. And since we've reached the internals, the 72Wh battery is also impressive, larger than I expected for a laptop of this size. In the box you'll also find a small but powerful 65W charger. It's smaller than many phone chargers I've come across recently. And now let's turn our attention to what truly matters. The beauty within. As I mentioned earlier, this is the first laptop we've tested with Intel's new Lunar Lake architecture. The processor here is the Core Ultra 7 258V with a mix of 4 performance cores and 4 efficiency cores, and a turbo boost frequency of up to 4.8 GHz. At launch, Intel claimed it was the fastest single-core processor on the market, and Asus runs it at a maximum PL1 of 22 watts. Let's start with synthetic tests and compare them with the other Snapdragon or AMD models we've tested. We began with Geekbench 6, and in multi-core, the S14 returned almost 10,000 points, 9,690 to be exact, and 2,467 in single core. For comparison, the Vivobook S15 with Snapdragon X Elite scored 14,648 in multi-core and 2,465 in single core, while the Lenovo Yoga Pro 7 with Ryzen AI 365 scored 14,115 in multi-core and 2,694 in single-core. What stands out immediately is the weaker multi-core performance of the Intel processor, but also that Intel didn't lie when they boasted about single-core speed. In other words, the single-core score is in line with the others, but as for multi-core, we're dealing with a chip that has only 8 cores in total. The next test was Cinebench 2024, and we chose not to test R23 due to compatibility issues with the ARM architecture. In Cinebench 2024, the S14 scored 418 points in multi-core, while the S15 with Snapdragon reached 971 points. The Yoga Pro 7 scored 992, and the ZenBook S16 with Ryzen HX 370 scored 968. I think you can draw your own conclusions. Core Ultra 7 258V is not a performance champ, but is clearly oriented towards efficiency. As for the famous NPU, the dedicated AI segment of the processor, the 258V sits between Snapdragon Axis 45 TOPS and Ryzen AI 9 HX 370's 50 TOPS. But as I said earlier, this is where the problem lies. While you're getting more and more TOPS, it's still unclear when users will see real benefits. In my opinion, at this point, these specifications are just numbers that don't mean much in terms of practical applicability. For video, the processor has an integrated Intel Arc 140V GPU, so we ran a quick 3D Mark test to see how it performs. In TimeSpy, we got an overall score of 3,647 points, with 3,462 on graphics and 5,241 on CPU. In FireStrike, we had an overall score of 6,800 points. These aren't great numbers, but they're predictable for this chip. Out of pure curiosity, we also ran CS2 to see how it compares to the other models, which, let's be honest, didn't excel either. Like this one, those are also ultra-thin laptops for productivity, office work, entertainment, or travel. At native resolution and low graphics settings, we averaged 60 frames per second, with noticeable stuttering in crowded scenes, which made the gaming experience rather poor. So, if we're to draw a conclusion from a performance standpoint, the new Intel Core Ultra 7 258V falls behind the processors launched this year, like Snapdragon X and AMD Ryzen AI. However, what Intel promises is efficiency and battery life. And indeed, according to the specifications, this is the processor with the lowest power consumption among them all. But does that translate into increased battery life? Yes and no. In our tests, the S14 managed around 15 hours in the battery test. It's better than the S16 with AMD, but not better than the Vivobook S15 with ARM. Of course, given the circumstances, we're talking about a high-resolution OLED panel, which also contributes to battery drain. But the laptop has a substantial battery despite its slimness, and I'm pleasantly surprised by the battery life of this Intel processor. Another topic worth discussing is cooling, always a problem with such thin portables. In this case, the laptop didn't get excessively hot in tests or during the short CS session. It didn't overheat too much at the keyboard or on the bottom, but it didn't excel in terms of performance either. The fan noise is discreet, and in the office, my colleagues didn't hear it even from a meter away, though some noise exists. It's a constant hiss that accompanies you whenever you give it more serious tasks to handle. But that's also normal given its few millimeters of thickness. The software experience is what I expected from any ZenBook. My Asus and Screen Expert are present. There's also something called Story Cube, which categorizes photos and videos by locations and people and blah blah blah. There are a few Intel utilities and the usual Windows Store on the taskbar. As we know, the Asus experience is far from stock. All in all, the S14 is as beautiful and elegant as a Windows laptop can be today. It's thin, light, responsibly built, has excellent connectivity, and this new Intel processor, while not the most powerful, fits well with this laptop designed for office work, travel, and watching movies. With 15 hours of battery life, it's no champion, but it's not at the bottom of the pack either. Moreover, this 258V is not the most powerful processor in the new Lunar Lake series, but performs decently in most common tasks, and in office browsing or multimedia, you won't notice any difference compared to the competition. If you're interested in raw power, core count, and apps that make the most of them, then look elsewhere. And the S14 should be definitely be judged based on price. In this exact configuration, with a Core Ultra 7 258V processor, 32 gigs of LPDDR5X RAM, 1TB SSD, and OLED touch display, the S14 costs $1,500, placing it within the range of elegant laptops with an emphasis on design and portability rather than performance. If you give up the touch feature, you'll save another 100 bucks. And with that said, let's hear from you in the comment section below. How do you like the new and stylish ZenBook S14? What do you think about Intel's new mobile processors and their newfound focus on efficiency? That's it for today, and if you made it this far, hit that subscribe button. Thank you and good luck to you all.